The time has come for my people to go.
I'm not a queen, I'm a servant of the people. I'm not a king, I'm a servant of the people. It's what the people demand, we gonna keep fighting till we get that land. I'm not a queen, I'm a servant of the people. I'm not a king, I'm a servant of the people. It's time to rise, to get what we want, we got to organize.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the ninth episode of the Pantsula podcast, brought to you by the All African People's Revolutionary Party. For those who are not familiar with the AAPRP, our objective is Pan-Africanism. And we define that as a total liberation and unification of Africa under scientific socialism. Every week, we honor one of our ancestors, two of our ancestors. And this week, we're going to honor Fred Hampton and the other one, being Harriet Tubman. And I guess Fred Hampton kind of gives away what we'll be talking about today. Because today we'll be talking about how Africans are depicted in Hollywood. So just to kick it off, I guess maybe you could start with essentially, you know, how do we normally see Africans depicted in Hollywood, essentially? Like, what roles and, you know, how does that play a role in our psyche on a day-to-day basis from consuming this stuff from the mass media?
Well, the first word I'm going to go with is magical Negro. I think we're all familiar with that one. Like, just typically the savior who isn't really specific to an origin, definitely not from Africa. Some sort of utopian place. And I think Africans just in general in media are regulated to such small spaces that when we are put in a, you know, other space that other Hollywood movies would have, you know, mostly casting non-Africans, we get, you know, happy and like it causes a celebration, right? Because it's like, oh, we see someone who's a something that's very common but just not often reflected. So I think typically Hollywood is specifically doing that for a reason, and I obviously we're going to go into why that is, but yeah, I would start off with the magical Negro because that's still one that Hollywood has been using since its conception. The Birth of a Nation. If no one has seen that, the first pretty much Hollywood movie, that tells you pretty much the agenda of Hollywood because that puts in context what they think of African people.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think normally when I watch these movies, it's the common themes I see in one. Is this white savior complex? You know, it's like at the end of the movie. It's always some white man may save you, come get you. You know, whether it's a biopic or it's a fictional movie, you see it all across the board. I know, like that movie. I know me and Jamila talked about it at one time. That movie on Steve Biko, essentially, which is just a mischaracterization of Biko and his movement. It was just all centered around, you know, that European, you know, he came to say it was like, you know, a few minutes on Biko. It's like, all right, can we give you this? But then it's like, oh yeah, the Europeans coming to come save you. You know, like we always do, whatever, you know, that's the message that they like to get across. So that's one of the things I see a lot of times. And I think, you know, on someone that's impressionable or doesn't engage in the rigorous study of our history, it's easy to fall for that narrative. And whether it's consciously or subconsciously, it's very dangerous because then you start relying on other people to come save you instead of having any type of self-determination.
Yeah. Oh, and one thing we talked about, the Jamila and I, we talked about, I mean, the art is political, everything is political, is noticing how even when there is a quote-unquote, like, positive or somewhat, like, mostly African, all African cast. There always is a sort of drawback that, you get your film with like, all these Africans, but we still got to get European there. Oh, we still got to make sure he helps us. Oh, we got to make sure that we're not advocating for actual liberation. We actually for some liberal equality or something, and when we're talking about Black Panthers, one of the things that even before the, you get to the CIA agent and all these other stuff in the end, is that one of the things is when I forgot, my girlfriend's gonna be mad if I forgot the names, but what do you think of Lupita's character was in they were in Nigeria. And like you could basically they're basically trying to rescue these young African girls, and what is that like you think of, like, bring back our girls.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's true. Yeah, man. It's so crazy to think about it. I mean, have you guys watched the Fred Hampton movie? Even, you know, given that we dedicated this episode to him and everything, but have you guys watched the movie yet?
I have not seen it. I don't typically watch movies. I mean, I used to love going to the movie theaters as a kid, but especially movies like this, I fear, you know, just kind of going into study about Chairman Fred Hampton and just seeing from Dr. Jared Ball and other people going into comprehensive study of him and just this whole film. I mean, it's caused a lot of stir. A part of me wants to see it just to have a critical perspective to see what they do to him, because undoubtedly, like all Hollywood films, they're going to always have a narrative and it's never in favor of African people. Just look at what Malcolm X looked like. I mean, that was a film.
Oh, man. Horrible.
Let's just say it's a horrible film because it doesn't give you an accurate representation of Malcolm's evolution, his Pan-Africanism, all of the highlight key components of what made Malcolm a revolutionary is exempt from that field purposely. Mm-hmm. So you can already see, obviously, with this film, they're doing the same thing, I believe. I'm not sure to what degree, but I don't usually watch films because, at least historical films, because I pretty much understand that they're going to sensationalize and make a mockery. It's downplaying. And from what I've seen, even of the trailer, they just show him screaming. Like, here is another black man screaming. He's mad about something. He's angry. Like, that already has a perception in the masses of people when they hear somebody screaming, especially someone screaming about justice. So,
go ahead.
Sorry. I haven't seen it myself, but I would like to see it. Like, and one of the things that kind of, like, even though I've seen and read like some stuff that are critical of it, and one thing that does want me to see is the fact that they're actually decent. Like for example, like his, like Fred's son, his widow, like Wimbush, Rosa Clemente, that they're involved, and like, so you're like, it's like you're tempting me,
Yeah. Like, that's what I'm saying. I mean, with knowing all the people involved, it's like I definitely want to see it now, and because of this work, to have an analysis, because his son has been critical with other revolutionaries talking about this film. So obviously, it's going to impact people. That I do enjoy, because hopefully more people are encouraged to rejoin an organization and to continue the work, because obviously we believe the best way to honor these people is to continue their work, because it's one thing to acknowledge their attitude and just the deliveries that they put in, but we have to also look at the work that they put in, and that's something we can continue, and we need more comrades to continue.
Yeah,
I kind of think you see obviously like stuff like this, in order for people to join organizations, like it does that, the after effects do change, and you're not sure how long it'll take, but it does say something that sort of like the relationship between like the role of media and sort of like manufacturing consent is that the take rate isn't, oh, all these, like, so many Africans are joining like revolution organizations, or they're joining, or even like trying to go further into the conspiracy. The thing you hear, like one thing I saw is about, oh, they want J. Edgar Hoover's name removed off the FBI building.
Yeah, exactly.
I didn't even hear that. See, that's just nonsense.
Yeah, you're going to remove that name, you still have political prisoners in there.
Right, you still got the prisoners in there. Y'all still doing the work for them.
Exactly. Same thing with, like, legalizing weed and stuff. It's like, you know. Oh, you legalize it, but you still have people in jail doing, you know, sentences for marijuana. So it's like, you know, I understand it's great going forward, but it's like, what about the damage it's done? You know, I'm not going to fix that. But yeah, I actually seen a movie recently. what I would say, you know, I've heard a lot of the criticism of it, and it's definitely right. But I guess Dialectics is like, you know, it was produced by a mass media company, so, you know, the production was great. You know, the way it was produced, it was good. But I guess it doesn't really get into regards to Fred Hampton's character. It's not really centered around him. I think some people probably go into thinking it is, but it's really the motive of it is to center around the, you know, the snitch, the traitor, essentially. And that kind of gives,
I mean, you have in the movie about Fred Hampton, but yet it's really about, I guess, the Black Judas. I guess that's what this, the whole theme is, like the Black Judas went against the Messiah.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like you sense it around him, and it's kind of like, all right, like William O'Neill. It's like, all right, but you know, people going into the end, like even leading up to the movie, you know, all the screenshots you see and everything is kind of like, oh, you know, Fred Hampton screaming, like you stating, like, you know, the berets and everything. So everybody was probably hyped, including me. It was like, oh, I wasn't hyped, I should say, but I was like, oh, okay, let's see what this is going to be about. You know, and then come to find out, you know, I kind of went into it knowing it would probably, you know, wouldn't be depicted all the way correctly. But I kind of watched it just to critique it and see what they left out. And they left a lot of Black Panther history out of it. They barely mentioned socialism throughout the movie. I think they mentioned it a few times. And I think one thing, too, is what caused the formation of the Black Panther Party? You know, like, what were the conditions that caused this to happen? You know, I think that this also leads to why we can't be reliant on the media to have us go and to engage in any type of active self-determination. You know, they're not going to tell us to go join an organization. You know, they don't.
The media's going to tell you to vote.
Exactly. Yeah. At least they won't tell you to join a revolutionary organization, I should say. Right. You know, they're gonna try to lead you to some like liberal path. He said, "Go vote or vote or die," whatever the case is. Yeah, I mean, is there any other movies that you guys could think of that that depicts Africans in a backward way in any way?
I'm not sure about a particular movie, but I know Jamil, when we were talking about how political everything is one thing that one movie that she particularly pointed out was Invictus. It was about the South African in Tanzania, the South African rugby team, and sort of portraying Nelson Mandela's old frail guy, and sort of like, and you would like, you wouldn't know that dude was like in, no, I won't try to say the built-in wing of the ANC. You won't hear about the way, like, when he was like coming out after his local imprisonment, like thanking Muammar Gaddafi, thanking the PLO, thanking Fidel Castro and the Human Communist Party. That you won't think like that's the same guy.
No, just like he was literally just like this, and he walked very slow. In the whole film, he talked like he had, it was clearly a mockery. That's the best way to say it was a mockery of who he was. And again, these are subtle things that the media knows will get past a lot of people.
Or like, and like you want, and even if you want to talk about like criticism of like the presidency and whether the ANC like did enough, like there were enough in reparations or enough as far as like an actual socialist program, rather and more of a like accepting the capitalist world, like you won't even get that. It's like, oh Africa, oh, the white African, the European Africans, the Africans, oh yeah, we're getting along, yeah, we got team.
yeah
I guess maybe let's try to get to the root and why we think the media portrays us in this way.
Dehumanization goes back to that continual, perpetual dehumanization, I would say. They know just to take our dignity, our self-determination, like you've been mentioning, it gives people that. And then it causes, when there is a change, then there's that celebration, because then people feel like, oh, we've made progress, that tokenism works. If you can isolate tokenism, like when you give the treat, like every 3 months or every 3 years, you know, it kind of numbs people's understanding that this is actually something. They are making these moves intentionally because they know we can't contribute nothing to the benefit of their interest. I mean, we can contribute something to our liberation, but they don't want that. They want us to continue to feel like we can incorporate ourselves to make the system work for us, when clearly the system isn't going to work for us. But the capitalist system has a way of just kind of rearranging the scene so that we feel, oh, well, I guess we can. And they know that it's emotional too. So like a lot of these characters that we're talking about, we resonate with them. Like we are emotionally connected to them. They have characteristics that we want to be like, so it's hard. So when you come against it, you're seen as some sort of like hard negative person for coming against this character, and they do that on purpose because the emotional side of it can really get to people, you know. You, and then it's like, well, what about the kids? You're gonna tell the kids not to be, to, you know, the kids love Black Panther, like, you don't want the kids to love Black Panther, like that's
giving my boy threw up the Wakanda,
like the Wakanda, like that's what, because that's what they use that as, that's the bait. It's like,
yeah,
you come against that, you're going against the kids.
Is that you? Man, do you want to talk about Wakanda? I mean, the Black Panther movie?
I mean, you, Evan and Jamila did an amazing podcast about that. But I mean, briefly, I can say about it. I remember watching it and thinking, even then, I didn't have nearly as much as an analysis as I have developed being in this organization then when I watched it. But even then, I was just like, I knew why, I was questioning why I felt good about it. Like, after watching, I'm like, okay, this makes me feel eerily, like, they did this on purpose. Like, this is not supposed to be so accepted. And then I watched it again, and then I saw the real criticism. And I'm like, yep. You know, so it's like, I resonated with the feel good. Like, there's a part where one of the characters says, oh, no, colonizer. Like, she uses the word colonizer. And a lot of people would just mention that, like, oh, like she's talking about Collins. It's like, if she really was talking about it, maybe he wouldn't actually win, because he actually won.
Exactly.
The CIA agent actually is the good guy in Black Panther.
Yeah.
So I have so many thoughts about that film. Ultimately, I think many people are lost in the symbolism because Wakanda's fictional, and it gives people another utopian, dystopian, mythical place to be in, to give refuge against, you know, the reality that this system is not for us. So
exactly. Yeah, somewhere to go and just a dream about, like, oh, okay, this is La La Land, and, you know, no real analysis on the conditions or anything like that. They leave all that out purposely. You know, they're just trying to liberalize, essentially, at the end of the day. And it's even documented that, you know, in John Patash's work, I can't remember the full name of it, it's a long title, but I'll put the name of the book in the description. But I know in his book, he kind of talked about infiltration of like the CIA and the government into Hollywood, because, you know, they wanted to make sure, they started to get, like, you know, more people in the military, pro cop stuff out there and stuff like that. So, you know, that's one of the things that, you know, average person may not know. You know, I didn't know until I actually started reading this stuff, and it's like, oh snap, okay, this is what they do, you know, and they infiltrate so many spaces that we don't even think of, but Hollywood is definitely one of them. You know, they don't want what happened in the '60s to continue to keep happening. You know, what happened on the continent throughout the DS4, where we were uprising and you know, mobilizing, and to a lesser degree, we were organizing too. So, you know, the media won't give us any type of revolutionary figures in the proper context, essentially. So yeah, man, I think it is what it is when it comes to the media. I think you just can't look at them. You can just look at it as a tool to critique and, you know, sit and watch. But I think you shouldn't internalize these things at the end of the day. So all it's going to do is just, you know, have us be our own enemies.
And one more, another thing I was thinking about is the thing about when at least I was growing up, how, like, a lot of times when you see any sort of a Hollywood representation of Africa, you see like a few different things. You might see some from wannabe voodoo or some like Africans or whatever drug, so like hocus pocus or something, like without like any sort of context there for the African traditional religion, or you see an Africa that somehow has no people in them just animals.
Yeah.
Like, we know that Africa is like a huge continent, and it's like not as like.
Like Sahara Desert is what y'all got.
we know it's like it's a freaking big country, even though like the Kata maps like won't say it, but and we know that even like the population growth is still like as fairly sparsely populated, but it's so weird like how often you'll see movies that are television where you see Africa and this. And no people are there, or the people are European, or
exactly. Yeah, you think of like Jumanji, you know, you think of Tarzan and stuff like that. Yeah. Those are some of them, especially Tarzan. I think is one of the movies that like, you know, makes you look at Africa completely different, you know, from what the reality is. It's like, you know, they just want to make it seem one. It's a European. Tarzan's probably colonized. I don't know. You gotta do a little homework on him, man.
Even more than like this.
Yeah. So it's like, you know, just that whole primitive notion of Africans or Africans being primitive is
revisionism.
Is crazy. Yeah, revisionism, white supremacy at the end of the day too. White supremacy narrative. Right. Yeah, to make you think that. You know, everything is
make you think Africa's poor, while at the same time the resources that fuel our modern world are from Africa.
Yet exactly.
Media or you know Hollywood, again to your point, like the CIA knew that they had to infiltrate these bases because they knew it would actually be a major component to influence people's minds. Because people really buy into this stuff. I mean, we already know with our phones, everyone's on the phone, everyone's kind of engaged in these conversations. And you talk to Africans and you hear what they perceive themselves of themselves. And it's like Malcolm said, it's like, who taught you to hate yourself? You ask those questions and you're like, oh, wow, okay, I'm actually identifying with tropes that are not established by the masses of my people. Mm-hmm. It's established by a select group of individuals that know what I like because they've tracked it long enough. So they've been able to follow. You get that awakening and you realize like these movies, and it's not that you can't enjoy, because again, we're scientists, we understand the dialectical approach. You can always watch a movie and find something out of it, enjoy aspects of it, but just please don't get your history from Africa, from Hollywood. That is not, you're gonna always be told, and it's like, yeah, literally most of the time, especially if it's funded by billionaires, if most films I believe cost little to like 800 to 100 million to produce. So, you know, with that kind of money, there's an agenda. It's going to be finely tuned and assessed to not include that components that would cause the masses of the people to actually educate themselves or organize. So, yeah, if you're going to watch a film, at least start with that disclaimer.
Yeah, exactly. Do your homework first before you watch. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And another point is I know there's, even though like we're socialists, we're communists, that we're understanding that you know, the point is to unify the scientific socialism. But another point is to this drive that we have to have ourselves in Hollywood media, which is basically the fourth wing of the United States government. That even if you do sneak like a sorry to bother you, or you do sneak a Sankofa, or you do sneak a Bukusat by the door, if you do sneak something and that reaches a decent audience, that it's going to be really difficult to establish like a consistent pattern of it. So you have to find ways to like produce stuff for yourself and find
Exactly. That's true. I think another aspect I want to go into is actually like the criminal characters as well. You know, that's something that we've seen displayed a lot over the last 30. Yeah. You can talk about that a little bit.
I mean, I'm thinking of that I haven't seen Training Day in a long time, but I do remember everyone. Mm-hmm. I believe that's the film that Denzel won an award, like the.
I think so. I think he won
the Academy. Yeah. But he was recently in trouble because he had this quote where he was actually. He was praising the cops. I mean, there's no other way of saying it. He was basically saying, I don't want to misquote him, but in so many words, he was like, oh, I don't see why people hate the cops. Like, these are the people who give their lives to us. It's like, what? But it makes sense to his character because he was, from what I remember of the movie, he was a character, he was a FBI informant that actually, I don't exactly.
He was like a crooked cop, essentially.
A crooked cop,
the white cop.
He
was a good cop.
The European cop was a good cop, you see?
Stay woke. Stay woke, man. Stay woke. Right.
So it's like, look at that. See how they literally put that in there, and then it's like it's meant to show you the opposing, like, hey, there's a good. See, they're kind of looking at themselves, like, hey, we know that there are some bad apples. Here's the black one, that's the bad apple. But then there's the European one who's upholding these. So these are subtle ways. And then also, and this is something going back to Ajamu Umi with this book that he just released. That I encourage everyone to buy. He mentioned something recently in a series of podcasts that he does, how these movies are done specifically because they know people are going to just like buy it in. And when you have that knowledge, you're not going to just take anything for grabs because you understand that it's connected to an overall premise. And also that most of these movies always end with our revolutionaries dying in a very dramatic way or being killed. Like, I'm not sure if you guys seen A Night in Miami. That's another new movie that came out, I believe.
No, I've never seen that.
Yeah, but that's apparently a fictional representation of what it was like for Malcolm X, Martin. It was several, I believe, what's his name?
Ali, Jim Brown, Sam Cooke.
Yes. All of them together in the same room. And so Regina King directed this film that fictionalizes what that scenario would have looked like. But apparently in that film, at the end, like the credits, they just put like Malcolm X was killed. Like they don't give you the details of how that happened or anything. It's just like, but that was intentionally done just to kind of show that point. Like, hey, if you out for justice, here's what's going to happen. Exactly. You know, you're gonna get assassinated. We're gonna get you. If you stand up against this, that's the message that I think most films portray, which is that if you're out doing your thing for justice for the people, they're gonna get you. They got you.
Exactly. Yeah, they wanna perpetuate that image that you don't go against the system because this is what we're gonna do to you if you do
it. Right, because this is what you try to do that. Right.
Exactly. There's no, you know, they're not gonna show the successful liberation struggles that happen and engage in history, obviously. At least they're not going to show it in the right context. They're going to, you know, disorient what happened during the whole thing. So,
Or even if someone is assassinated, again, it goes back to the point of the individual hero that, like, if a Malcolm X or a Patrice Lumumba, Thomas Sankara is killed, and then that's it. Everything, you go home. You go back to normal. Instead of thinking of how many people like actually like apply their work later on, or as you said, you don't see like you know. I think there actually was. I could be wrong, so if anyone could correct me. I think there was. A movie about like the Haitian Revolution, like decades ago.
Oh, I certainly haven't seen it.
I know, but it was like, that FBA guy, Tariq Nasheed, made some like 1804. I think he made one on Haiti.
And speaking of which, you see like another thing that you see about. A lot of, like some African movies portrayals in Hollywood is the not just like criminal like the individual criminal but like the sort of strong man African dictator or military dictator.
Oh yes, the last king of Scotland. Mm-hmm. Is what I think of. I see that with
really
Forrest Whitaker. Yeah, it's always like the abrasive. There's not a lot of obviously inclusion for non-binary representation. That's usually never, I mean, media is always, you get that, like, need I mention Tyler Perry?
Oh, man. Man.
That's all I need to say. I don't have to say nothing. I already said a sentence. There's a paragraph in that.
Mike, walk out the room, man. That guy, man. You watch one of his movies, man. You, man, you're going to be.
Tropes. And see, those things can be identified, like a lot of people, because let's also understand that a lot of people love Tyler Perry, right? So a lot of people can identify with those general tropes that he puts out. But when you really do an analysis of it, it's like, no, this can't be seen as actually progressive, effective for the people, something that's a reflection or a help for the people, when it actually resorts to just these general stereotypes that are just drenched in patriarchal sentiment.
Like colorist,
colorist, yeah, colorism. So many levels of problematic.
Misogyny, whatever, pro-capitalist.
Right.
Type of stuff, yeah.
Reactionary religious.
Yeah.
That's one he uses often, because that's usually the game. That's his target market, is the church folks. Mm-hmm. So,
you know, try to find ways to make the people, you know, just be drenched in docility and, you know,
right,
do anything, be pacifist and stuff. It's like, man, this is crazy.
I know his, I think the last series I remember watching of his was Greenleaf. And I remember at the time, because it dealt with the church, and it kind of showed the church in a business aspect. It kind of broke down I appreciated that angle, like just showing how a lot of these mega churches operate. But it was interesting how he really handled these conversations. You know, he knew how to always add a bow to it at the end. And that's what people want, right? They want the bow. They don't want you to give them the real, like, take this, deal with it. And if it makes you choke for a little bit, deal with it. They rather get the bow at the end. And he always knew how to do that. And that goes again to our last podcast where we talked about criticism. And he is someone who cannot take criticism. He has been criticized by black women specifically over and over about his choices. And he's like, no one can tell me what I'm doing. I make all of this stuff. And it's like, if you're not able to receive criticism from the group that you are using and exploiting, you shouldn't even have this right to make these films. Like, you should have that honesty. But that just goes to show, like, if a film can't show and represent the masses of African people in a way that gives us our self-determination and shows that we are human beings, I don't watch it. Like, because we've seen so much also trauma of our experiences being used in film as profit. Mm-hmm. That's usually what happens as well. Like, people make, like, even we can talk about the documentaries that Jay-Z's made about, you know, Khalif Browder,
how do you feel about that, man?
What do you think about sort of this is for the 13th?
I forgot about that. And I know Netflix has the one on the Black Panthers, and what's it called? I can't think of the name of it. I can't remember. But there's one on, there's more recent one that's on Netflix that's on the Panthers, and them going to trial and Bobby Seale, you know, being gagged in the courtroom and stuff like that.
Oh, wow.
You know, once again, you know, they just show, they reduce it to, you know, handguns and berets and just rhetoric and people screaming and stuff like that. And they only show a glimpse of, like, what the Black Panther Party was really about. So, yeah, it's kind of sick.
You don't talk about the breakfast program or the self-defense.
Nothing.
Or the international solidarity.
Exactly. Right. Yep. I mean, just radicalizing have a coalition to radicalize the street gangs too as well. You know, not all that is left out. You know, and it's, they only leave it to a few members. They don't talk about the role of, like, the Panther 21 or, like, you know, Phoenix Shakur or Sekou Odinga and all, you know, Lumumba Shakur. Like, all these people have roles too as well within a party. They reduce it to, like, one or two figures and kind of individualizing it. You know, if you know the system, that's what it's based off of, just individualism. At least that's what they're trying to breed. So, So definitely, you know, read about these figures before you watch them if you can, man. And we definitely implore you to do so.
You know, and also think about, like, not only, and also, like, which organizations do get the hype and why. Like the Black Panther Party. You don't think they definitely wouldn't be showing, like, these, like, large, like, movies. Like, right when, like, when they're still active, they have to wait till decades after.
Oh, yeah.
Or, like, for example, like, you see people like, oh, I want a movie about Sasada, or I want a movie about Marcus Garvey, or, right. Like, for one, when, like, Are they really going? Do you really think that Iowa's going to have a Marcus Garvey film?
Right. Come on.
Any quality that it actually shows there, or do you think they're going to show like the fifth Pan African Congress? Or are you going you're going to see Queen? You might see a Queen Nzinga movie, but I don't know. Like you want to do that, but are you going to see? Are you going to see anything about the Black Liberation Army?
Yeah, they're definitely not gonna do anything on the Black or the MOVE organization. They're not gonna do anything on MOVE neither, because they bombed them as well. So there's no way. I mean, you know, I wouldn't put it past the mass media to liberalize that too. But I don't know how you dice that up, but to make it kind of liberal.
People have a thirst, is like you said, Evan. People, they have a thirst for it. They're like, they want films like this. People want to see it, and that goes to show you just the stranglehold of media on a lot of people's consciousness as it relates to history. I mean, you can learn about these people easily by going to a library, reading a book, mm-hmm. and you'll find way more obviously truthful an analysis of them as opposed to a movie. But people want that quick oatmeal like information, and that's what films do, because it, you know, you're seeing it, you're hearing it, you know, there's a soundtrack. It's an experience that, again, I can appreciate a great film, but if you're not going to give the real story, which is important, then you're just, it's not going to be effective to the masses. But unfortunately, people just coddle to the tokenism, because that's enough. Because we haven't seen ourselves. We ain't hardly nowhere. We've been like, we ain't nowhere. So it's like, so this, like, Harriet Tubman is another person. Like, look at what they did to her. I mean, now they're trying to put her on the $20 bill.
Yeah. It's crazy, and it's sad too, because these people left work for us, you know, for us to read. A lot of them did, or people have written great works on them. Like, I think of the, like, for instance, like, we're talking about the Black Panther Party. You have Huey P. Newton, and you have his several works that he's done. You know, I have only a few of his stuff. You know, To Die for the People. You have Posada, which we read in part of our the works that you.
This is how you know about these people.
This is how you know about these. Yeah, they left work for us to understand who they are and their ideas. You know, that that is still here with us, you know. And you mentioned Marcus Garvey, you know, he literally has a book called Philosophies and Opinions. So Marcus, I don't know why you
why wouldn't you like read that?
He tells you what he thinks in his books. Like, you know, there's a book called Garvey and Garveyism. Like, you know, his wife you know, put out a lot of his work. So it's like, why would you need to go to watch a movie about this?
Like, or both wives, like Amy Jock and Amy Ashwood. Like, they both they were great organized, and they have great work in themselves. Or Queen the Moore, she was like just everywhere. Like, she lives to almost 100. Like, she was just everywhere. Garvey, Communist Party, like Public New Africa, all this stuff. Like,
hey, come on, yeah. It's like, you know, you don't have to dig into that. I mean, also too, I think the other side of it is like the independent part of it, where you know, we seen like watching Winnie was so great, you know, that was like a more accurate depiction. So I think there's stuff out there, but we have to do digging. We can't rely on, you know, Time Warner or, you know, whatever, you know, conglomerate that's out there. What happened?
Like, the five corporations that run like 90% of media.
Exactly.
We can't rely on them to tell the story.
Yeah, hyper-capitalist only care about one thing, and it's money. And that sensationalism brings them money when you think about the media. So, yeah, so they're going to do anything to create that hype around it to get that dollar.
And the African is reduced to just, like, we speak of all of these different tropes, and when it comes to the business side of it, like, just being venture capitalists. Jay-Z or someone, you know, or even, dare I say the word, the B word, the Beyonce.
But yeah, then, you're trying to have our YouTube channel shut down, bro. No. We have about to get it set down.
I just believe that in terms of revolution, I mean, you can't look at people like that to find that analysis. They're not going to encourage you to look for the people. They're encouraging. I mean, this thing has to just be approached sincerely, and we can just see through the industry. It's not just movies. It's in the music industry. I mean, all industries, capitalists has their appendages in, and they've invested their agents to mislead the masses. It's not a conspiracy. I mean, the papers, you can look at the CIA papers that they have out. I mean, mm-hmm. they've been doing this work. And yeah. and that's why joining an organization is important, because it helps you understand just how these things work, so that you're not as, because they can easily, and they've upgraded their ways of selling this information. They know mm-hmm. how to give what, you know, like if they can take down a statue and people celebrate it, that's just like, they're like, whew, they're not in the streets, you know? They're like in Haiti or in Guatemala, where the people are like, yo, we coming.
And you notice how that isn't like publicized, you know, like the what's going on in Haiti right now.
Oh,
is there anything else? Yeah, you know,
cute people, dogs, cute cats, celebration. That's the stuff we get on the media, like all of those distractions. Like,
I don't know about you, man. I don't know. I listen to Beyonce, and it's like, man, I get liberated, right? We liberated. Racism is over. Capitalism is over. Now, I'm just saying it's the same face, so that the Beehive don't come shut our stuff down. So,
right. You see,
they hardcore.
We did it, y'all. We did it.
Right, exactly. I'm not hating on them. I'm just saying.
Yeah, man. It is what it is with them, man. I mean, you know. You can't look to these type of individuals to express our interests. You know, at the end of the day,
like that, our intro says, we're not a king or a queen. Sorry, I know they call a king bee, but we not a king or a queen. We are a servant of the people.
Yes,
that's exactly.
Listen to the intro. Is that what?
Intro. Like, yeah, I know you like Beyonce, but listen to the intro. Jamila put her thing down on that.
So I guess that concludes this episode of the Cantula podcast. We appreciate you guys coming on board and listening. You know, you can tune in every Monday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for all of our latest episodes. But until then, or whatever, see you guys.
Forward.
Forward.